CSCS exam prep, we are talking nutrition. This is the big one. I've identified three big areas that people have problems with, and we're gonna fix those, and we are starting right now. What's going on? My name is David Barr, and if you want to do well at your CSCS exam, or you're looking to get bigger, faster, stronger, get leaner, go longer, hit that subscribe and then the little bell so you don't miss the latest tips and tricks. Today, we are talking everyone's favorite, maybe not favorite, but certainly my favorite, we are talking nutrition. Nutrition can be a bear on the exam. A lot of people have problems with it. In my time with the CSCS exam, I've identified three main areas that we need to address, things we need to make as simple as possible to help you succeed for the exam. So starting off with the part of threes, we're going to identify those three components, including a question I've developed. A lot of people that I'm tutoring find this to be very, very helpful. So we'll cover that one at the end. And then at the very, very end, we will go through the next three steps that you're supposed to take to help you increase your chances of succeeding on the exam. So right away, this is all based on my experience, okay? This is not NSCA official. It's not endorsed, supported by the NSCA, nothing like that. I have been doing CSCS exam prep for many years, tutor people, really help increase chances of success, which is fantastic. That's a very exciting part for me because it's the whole rising tide lifts all boats thing. If we can get more certified people in the industry, we'll have a more educated overall, you know, body of people in the industry, really help reduce that chance of injury, increase performance, all of that good stuff that we want to do. Okay, so that's my motivation, but be sure to check the official NSCA documents when it comes to your exam, because nothing I say can be taken as dogma and it could differ from what's going to be on your exam. Okay, disclaimer out of the way. So the story is, this one kicked off. I was giving an exam prep and we were doing nutrition. We were talking nutrition calculations. Those are pretty rough, and we'll talk about that in a second, but we went through the hour of the nutrition talk and that backed on to lunch. So a woman had some fantastic questions during the actual talk, but they kept going through lunch. So I was super eager to help her, and we ended up going through about 50 minutes of the hour-long lunch trying to explain very basic nutrition concepts and the very basic math. And the problem is, by the end of it, she was nearly in tears. And that was my fault for not recognizing that, because the reality is she was just so overwhelmed that she couldn't take in any more information. So I should have recognized that and said, hey, it's cool. You're not incapable of getting basic math, which is all this was. It's really just that you're in information overload mode. So take some time off, take an hour lunch, ideally, then take the night, sleep on it, and come back, and you'll be able to get this. It will be no problem for you. So that's what I should have done. It's not what I did. But the point is, if you are experiencing that kind of stress and frustration, don't let yourself get there, okay? Back off a little bit, give yourself some time to figure out the calculations, okay? It is basic math, so there's nothing on the exam that you won't be able to figure out very, very simply, okay? Very easily. So when it comes to the numbers, and yeah, you need to know the numbers, okay? For the macros, the macronutrients. So carbs, protein, fat, the 449 calories respectively per gram. Make sure you know those. And if that's new to you, if those calories per gram are new to you, then you just have a little more work to do to get up to speed. Okay, so you're going to take some time to get familiar with what that means. And then you can really dive into those calculations and then start crushing them. Okay, so not going to go into super detail about the calculations. Just again, know the macros, know what types of athletes need what percentages of the macros. I haven't seen anyone need micronutrient dosing, so I wouldn't worry about that. Just stick with the macros and what people need and the caloric equivalents, because you will likely be given questions about that. So for any math question, two steps. What do you have? What are the numbers that you're given? And then what do you need? And then you figure out how you can take what you have and get what you need. Okay, so when you're practicing your questions, work through it like that. Start to think in that way, and you'll really be able to pick up on what it is you need to do to find that answer. Next step. Again, you need to know the numbers. I cannot stress that enough. Yes, there are a lot of numbers. I think that's one of the reasons people find this to be one of the more challenging components of the exam, but it's really not that bad if you just put a little time into it and then practice those numbers. Now, the math is simple, but I want to be clear about this. I'm not saying it's easy, okay? In no way is this easy, especially when you are in the middle of an exam. There is a lot going on, okay? You have a lot on your mind. You have dozens of questions to go through. There's a lot going on. So it's simple, but not necessarily easy. So if you find yourself, you think you could get stressed out during the exam because you're human, as most people do, I strongly recommend taking a look at another video in this series. It's all about the secret weapon of exam prep, and that is exam day preparation. That's another video. I'll link to that in the top right, so be sure to check that one out. The next one, this is conceptual, and it's very specific. I'm not sure why this gives people problems, but it is something that you need to be aware of for your exam. Concept of glycemic index. This is a theory. It is a numerical rating of how quickly an ingested carbohydrate gets into your blood. The higher the number, the faster it is said to be in your blood. And I think what confuses the issue a little bit is that we tend to think of food as being gone and just in our bodies once it's in our mouths. We don't really take the time to think that, okay, it has to go down into our stomach, has to be broken down a little bit, has to go into the small intestine where it's really digested and absorbed. So all of these processes take time, okay? It doesn't just automatically happen. But the faster this happens, the faster a substance can get into our blood. In the case of glycemic index, that is going to be the carbohydrate component. How quickly is the glucose getting into our blood? Okay, so you don't have to memorize this diagram at all. It's just to illustrate the point that food doesn't simply disappear into our bodies once it leaves our mouths, okay? It has to go through a variety of processes, so there are different speeds of digestion and absorption. And again, the glycemic index is meant to indicate how quickly that happens. So for example, a number of 100 is going to be a very, very fast digested and absorbed carbohydrate, whereas a lower number, say 20, is going to be a slowly absorbed and digested carbohydrate. That glucose is just going to trickle into the blood very, very slowly. That's the theory, okay? You don't have to memorize numbers, just know the general concept. Similarly, based off the glycemic index, and like the previous numerical idea, if you didn't know the 449 calories per gram, you just have some extra steps to take. Well, if this idea of the glycemic index is new to you, you just have a little bit more work to do to really get up to speed in terms of the glycemic load. Okay, not a big deal. It's not super complicated. And again, you don't have to do calculations for this. You don't have to memorize numbers or anything like that. Okay, it's really just the concept. So for this glycemic load, we know that, okay, we take the glycemic index, how quickly a carbohydrate gets into our blood once it's ingested. Building on that, if you're consuming 5 grams of a carbohydrate and it has a super high glycemic index, who cares? Because yeah, it's getting into your blood very, very quickly, but there's only 5 grams of it, so it's not significant in any way. This is what the glycemic load is intended to account for. It is basically a measure of not only the glycemic index, but also how much carbohydrate is in that food. Okay, so my favorite example is going to be watermelon. Very similar to that 5 gram thing. Okay, super high glycemic index, relatively speaking. But how much actual carbohydrate are we consuming when we consume watermelon? Well, I mean, what is watermelon mostly, right? People say water. No, it's wrong. The answer is deliciousness. Then it comes carbohydrates. Then, okay, the water is next. You're right, it's water. But the key is there's not a lot of carbs in the watermelon, okay? That's key. So that is what the glycemic load is going to account for. So the glycemic load is going to be relatively low for watermelon consumption because we, yeah, great, super high glycemic index, but not very much quantity, okay? A relatively low quantity of carbohydrates, okay? So the combination of how much carbohydrate and how fast, that's going to give you your glycemic load. And again, higher is going to be a more significant impact, okay? Don't have to memorize the numbers, don't have to do calculations. If this is profoundly confusing to you, I strongly recommend checking out another video I had. It's on dangerous carbohydrates, and it's not CSCS specific, but what it does is it gives, I think, a nice walkthrough of the whole blood sugar rise concept and how that can be manipulated in different ways and what that looks like. And there's some moving graphs that I think people find to be very, very helpful. So again, I'll link to that in the top right, and I encourage you to check that one out. Okay, this is the question. To be very clear, this is an unofficial exam question. This is not in any way going to be on your exam. I have no specific insight or secrets about this particular question. This is really just something I came up with to challenge the people that I tutor to really help ensure that they understand all of the concepts, okay? So this is going to be a very challenging question. It is not meant to be overtly intimidating, because once we walk through it, you'll see how simple it is. And then once you get through these harder types of questions, you get to your exam, everything's going to seem much easier because the questions won't be this difficult. Okay, so here's the question. Which of the following is a gluconeogenic substrate? The options are lactate, leucine, or both. Now, how do we answer this question? Okay, that's the key, right? I'm not expecting you to get the answer. Congratulations to Mark, the intern, who was the first person to get this without being given the answer. But for most people, the point is to walk through this, figure out how we're going to do this. So where do we start? Break it down. Start with the question, what the hell is gluconeogenic? Now, if you are unfamiliar with that term, again, not a problem. It just means you have a little bit more work to do in terms of the basic terminology that you need to know. The good news is you can actually figure it out somewhat based on the word itself. And this is a key point for the exam. If there are unfamiliar terms, you can often break them down and figure out what they mean. Okay, that's a huge tip. Make sure you're aware of that concept when you go into your exam. So gluconeogenic, one of my favorite examples. What does it mean? Let's break it down. Gluco, meaning glucose. Neo, meaning new, or the matrix in this case, probably new. Third one, genic, okay? Genesis, creation of. So it's going to be the creation of new glucose. Pretty straightforward once you break it down like that. So you might see an intimidating long word you've never seen before. You can often break it down, okay? Don't be intimidated by that. You can figure it out. The next step, what are lactate and leucine? What are these things? That's where you really need to know the different components. So what is lactate? And you don't need to know for this particular question, but it's a good idea to have the background on lactate. What is it? When is it produced? What does it do? What are the related hormones? That kind of thing. Maybe most importantly, know that it does not cause fatigue. Okay, that one is a whole other video. We'll talk about that later, but lactate does not cause fatigue, right? So once you understand that background, you figure out whether or not it's related to the creation of new glucose. Same thing with leucine. Leucine is a very important amino acid. You do not have to memorize the amino acids. Good news, right? But you should know leucine. What is leucine? Okay, firstly, it's an essential amino acid. Getting more specific, it is one of the three branched chain amino acids, isoleucine, valine being the others. And more importantly, leucine is actually known as the anabolic trigger colloquially. Obviously, you don't need to know that component for the exam, but it might be responsible for stimulating muscle protein synthesis. And I talk about that in another video, go into gory detail. But for the exam, just know, what is leucine? What does it do? Again, you don't have to memorize the amino acids. So getting to the actual question, what is going to be the gluconeogenic substrate? Answer, it's going to be, I don't want to spoil it for you, but the answer is going to be both, okay? It's going to be A and B. Both the lactate and leucine can be converted into glucose. So there's a relatively simple answer, and it's okay if you didn't get that. Again, this is meant to be a more challenging, in-depth question that tests a bunch of different areas of your knowledge. But again, if you can nail these types of questions, the harder questions, you're going to walk into that exam and just be that much more confident and comfortable and be able to hammer out whatever is in front of you. Okay, so that's the goal here. Now, to build on that, there is a bonus question. Let's call it two bonus questions. That is referring to lactate. So the question I have for you, lactate, what? We know the hormonal component. We know that it's involved in metabolism. But specifically with regard to gluconeogenesis, what is the pathway called for lactate and gluconeogenesis? There's a name for it. And where in the body does that occur? So I'm not going to answer that one. You can answer it in the comments below if you want, or just one of those things, get to know it yourself. And it's part of that background information that will really help give you that confidence going into the exam. Okay, so we have those three different components. Here's your next steps, things that you should be going through. Identify your greatest opportunities for improvement. That is the things that you don't know as well as maybe you should. That is where you should probably invest your time. Yes, we all want to be where we're comfortable. We want to go through the stuff we already know. That's not the ideal way to succeed for the exam. The real way to do it is to tackle where your weak points are, those greatest opportunities for improvement, because even short amounts of time invested in that can really help to improve scores that much greater. It's ROI, return on investment, okay? So figure out where those opportunities are. Make sure you know your numbers for nutrition, and be sure to understand concepts. And we went through glycemic index, glycemic load. Don't need to know the numbers for those two, but again, it's concepts. It's all about the concepts, okay? And then we can extrapolate, we can apply. Do not memorize, okay? Certain things you have to memorize, like the numbers, but then you have to apply it with those questions, right? That's where we get into the applied side of things. Next step, be sure to understand how the questions work. Read through those questions carefully. Break down the different elements of the words that you don't know. Totally cool if you don't know a word. You can probably figure it out based on what the components of the word are, the context of the question or the answers. There is usually some kind of clue in there, okay? They're not just gonna trick you and give you a new word that you have no idea, you've never seen before, okay? So you can probably figure it out. So don't worry about that. Also, take advantage of every opportunity you can to gather information for this exam. So there's practice exams, be sure to check out the official Facebook forum, and definitely take advantage of this CSCS exam prep series. There are a few other videos you're going to want to check out. Make sure you understand all the concepts within those. And again, it's really just taking advantage of the opportunities you have to be as successful as possible on the exam. Lastly, you can take advantage of the subscribe. Make sure you get those updates when I publish new videos like this. I definitely want to hear from you about your questions. What types of things do you want me to address in videos? I haven't seen anyone else do this. I really want to give you the opportunity to give me the feedback. What do you need, and where can I be of assistance? Where can I help you succeed for your exam? So that is the CSCS exam prep for nutrition. You have your marching orders. Thanks for watching. My name is David Barr. Until next time, raise the bar.